This is the place for a Worldcon. A city on a human scale, with a sense of direction and a sense of purpose. Here, at the heart of science fiction fandom in Australia, a weary executive returns to his seat of office. And this is Paul Stevens, a slippery shop assistant with sinister ambitions. Too long reviled by lesser fans, he answers an urgent summons and assumes the evil identity of Antifan. He has an assignation with Fanarchist, a sinister visitor from overseas, whose mission is the assassination of the Australia in 75 Committee and the effective destruction of Australia's plans for a world science fiction convention. And the instrument of his endeavor will be Antifan. These are the despicable plans for the elimination of the committee and all its works. Meanwhile, in another part of the city, the bidding committee gather at the palatial home of John Foister. Unaware of the malevolent threat lurking nearby. The committee confer, unaware of an unseen eavesdropper. Their urgent business successfully completed, the committee dispersed. But what of Antifan? What evil business does he contemplate with such vicious delight? Relieved for the moment of his considerable responsibilities, a weary John Foister returns with pride and affection to his treasured library of old American pulps, there to continue work for his doctorate on overseas reviews of early Australian fanzines. Later, life returns to Melbourne fandom, stimulated by contact with important overseas fans. Here, at the GPO, Peter House and Dave Grigg collect their mail. What news from the Secret Masters? Wait, what strange news is this? And why is House so happy? Let us follow them as they hasten off to their mysterious rendezvous. Grigg, the live coward, makes good his escape. To ease his burden of guilt, a sorrowful Grigg invests his life savings in a shiny new car. For its very first outing, he takes the rest of the committee on a leisurely tour of possible convention sites. Thank you. By a devious route, the committee finally arrive at the building site of the new Hilton Hotel. They consider it a possibility, if finished in time. Deep in their discussion, they are unaware that danger lurks nearby, and that yet another of their company is doomed. Better death than dishonor. Stunned by the untimely death of yet another of their number, the remainder of the committee slowly make their way back to Griggs' shiny new limousine. Evil fiend has struck again. Lee Edmund's heart is heavy, and his mistress, Valma Brown, makes an effort to console him and ease his tormented heart. But wait! What black mischief is this? Does evil never rest? And so the deadly vendetta continues. Can there be no end to this scourge? Must this abominable evil prevail? But life goes on. And here, amidst the forced and shallow gaiety of the Golden Age Hotel, thirsty fans and weary fellow travelers have gathered to remember with affection their dear and departed mates. While back in the heart of the city, faced with such terrible danger, Binns does not hesitate. This is a job for Aussie Fan. The forces of good have triumphed at last, thanks to Aussie Fan. And the women of Melbourne show their appreciation in a characteristic fashion. This is victory. This is the reward. This is a hero's welcome. And this is the end. I think it's the end.